Welcome. Glad to have you here at Heritage United Methodist Church. I'm Steve Castile, one of our pastoral staff, and we want to welcome those who are joining us online and virtually on this Father's Day. I'm going to ask all the fathers to stand up. Everybody that is a father, stand up. Let's express our appreciation. If you have raspberries, do them later, because sometimes dads get on your nerves, and so they get applause and raspberries. But we thank you for being here. I'm blessed. My dad is one of my heroes. Made so much difference in my life, and so blessed to have a Christian father and Cindy the same way. So we celebrate our fathers, and for those who don't have good relationships with their fathers, then we pray for you and pray for healing and pray for comfort. Usually when that's the case, there are other people that kind of become our surrogate fathers and step into our life and bring leadership, and we're thankful for them. Today, as we come to worship, at the end of each pew, at one end or the other, is a blue or a green registration pad. This is part of our hospitality, but also part of pastoral care. And since it's many of us are making our way back into worship, we've lost the habit of kind of passing that and registering our attendance. And so if you're sitting by the pad, you are now steward of that pad. You look at your row. If it's not beside you, you sign. If somebody else comes, make sure that they sign. If you're a guest, it's a way for us to know you're here. We will not harass you or wear you out. It just lets us know that you were here. If you have concerns, there's a place for pastoral care concerns, prayer requests. If you'd like to have a meeting with the pastor, all that's there. And we do read those. The ushers take them up, and then we take time to take a look at them. So please make that part of your regular routine as you gather. Today is Father's Day, is the day that the baby bottles, if you were a part of Baby Bottle Boomerang, it's kind of like Peter Piper picks a peck of pickled peppers, the Baby Bottle Boomerang ends today. If you forgot to bring the bottle back, that even gets worse. Then bring it this week. So Baby Bottle Boomerang, bring bottles back as soon as you can. And we are so thankful for Hope Ministries and what they do. Our youth are back. Thank you for your prayers for them. Bless Scott's heart. He got a little food poisoning on the trip and kind of had some side activity that he had to kind of suffer through. But the kids had a blast and had to come back a day early because of the weather. And now it cleared off. So you just never know. But they had a great time. Thank you for your prayers and support of them. Let's bow our heads and begin our worship together. Almighty and everlasting God, we come to you as our Heavenly Father, the one who made us, the one who loves us more than we can imagine. And so we thank you for that. And we pray that as we worship, all our music, all our prayers, all our time together will glorify you and honor you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. Please stand if you're able, and well, let's praise God.
Thank you.
remain standing and join us as we share in this historic confession of our Christian faith, which is the Apostles' Creed. Let's join together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Sit down. Last week we reinstituted our fellowship time. For those of you who may be here for the first time, it's kind of an opportunity for us to catch up and visit with each other, to shake off the COVID rust that we've had and being within 6 feet of each other. And I will say this, if you feel uncomfortable with that, just kind of put your hand up and we'll honor that. We want everybody to feel safe and secure. But as you move about, let me remind you of how this works, because last week you forgot. When the music starts, that means you begin to make your way back to your pew and sing with us rather than waiting on me having to call you back, and then you can visit a little words afterward. So look around and welcome those who are guests and fellowship together. Y'all did much better. We tried to make the song longer to give you a little time to get back in the habit. It feels so good for many of you. Some of you are back for the first time again. Each week it seems like more folks rejoin the fellowship. We're so glad to have you. And for those who are watching online, thank you for joining us every week. We remind you there are comments there where if you're watching on video, you can share your prayer requests and make any comments that'll help us with pastoral care. As we come to the time of offering, I have to say two things. One is, in this past year where things could have gone a lot of ways, your generosity helped us navigate the year well. And as we begin to get back in person, as we move into the summer, I just have to be blunt. Summer is usually when financially we get in trouble, when everybody's on vacation and you get out of the rhythms and all of a sudden we're 30 or 40,000 behind in our giving. And so I urge you, if you're not giving electronically, to please mail in your check if you're not going to be here. Support the ministries that we do depend on your generosity. There are very few organizations that live on the generosity of those who are a part of it. And that's what makes every week we're in ministry such a miracle, is because of your generosity, we're able to do the things we do. So we thank you for that. We're going to invite the ushers, if they will, to take the offering at this time. You may be seated. As we come to our time of prayer, I want to take just a little extra time today. When you become a member of Heritage United Methodist Church, you make some vows. And the vows are that you'll support the church with your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness. And when we say prayers, it's a reminder that as the community of faith, we are each other's keepers. And that just because we don't know somebody doesn't mean we don't carry the privilege of being able to pray for them. And the other thing is that when you make the covenant to pray, God's kingdom operates very organically. To each of us, we have circles of friendships, circles of family, circles of relationships. And as Christians in those circles, we have the privilege and the responsibility to lift up those in those circles in our individual prayer life and in our daily relationship with them. And so as we come to prayer, I challenge you this week to take a look at how you honor that commitment. Who do you pray for regularly? Who do you lift up in your circles? Who do you feel God prompting you to care about? And I'm going to say this. One of the ways that we do this in this new age is that, how many of you have smartphones? How many of you feel they're smarter than you are? That's a, you know, they listen to what you're saying. Use those smartphones as tools of prayer. One of the new disciplines I've created is every day I go to a text list and I try to go down that list and just text, praying for you today, thinking of you today. It's amazing in this busy world how simple it is to bring people under the power of prayer. And I have friends who do that for me. They'll text in and say, just praying for you today. Thank you for what you do. There is this incredible kind of mysterious gift we've been given that's not just talking to God. It's talking as God's community. And so don't kind of run past that wonderful privilege and responsibility you have to pray every day. Let's bow our heads. Almighty and everlasting God, with humility we come into your presence, knowing that we can bring nothing to you but our love and adoration, our confessions and our repentance, and knowing that you have something to say to us. Father, our hearts are in deep need of your words. Not just the words in Scripture, but your voice to our soul. Messages that transcend words. Messages that edify us, encourage us, inspire us. Help us as we grow in our faith to listen more and speak less in our prayer life. To take every opportunity to be bluntly honest with the things we wrestle with and the help we need. And to have the faith to know that no prayer we offer up goes unanswered. And remind us that because a prayer is not answered the way we want, does not mean it hasn't been answered. Be with us as a community of faith as we love and care for each other. And allow us to take the promptings of your Holy Spirit to become the answer to each other's prayers as you would direct us. Lead us to the places we're needed. Open our hearts that we might pour out the compassion that others might need for their healing. And Lord, also humble us that when we need the prayers and love of others, that we ask for that. Be with us as we continually look at your commands. And help us to understand that we are trustees of everything in this world, including our faith and your kingdom. May we steward it well. All these things we pray in the name of Jesus, who taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let's join together as we sing the first verse of I Need Thee Every Hour.
Today's scripture, the first one is Exodus chapter 20, verse 15. Do not steal. The next one is Matthew 5, verses 42 through 48. Give to those who ask, and don't refuse those who wish to borrow from you. You've heard that it was said, you must love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who harass you, so that you will be acting as children of your Father who is in heaven. He makes the sun rise on both the evil and the good, and sends rain on both the righteous and the unrighteous. If you love only those who love you, what reward do you have? Don't even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your brothers and sisters, what more are you doing? Don't even the Gentiles do the same? Therefore, just as your heavenly Father is complete in showing love to everyone, so also you must be complete. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Over the last several weeks, we've been talking about the Ten Commandments. And we've been doing it in what I think is just a beautiful way. That is, we talk about the commandment in the Old Testament, and then we take what Jesus had to say about it in the New Testament. And the rhythm that's happened is in the Old Testament, we kind of learn that those thou shalt nots become the boundaries of our lives. Those 10 thou shalt nots set up kind of the foundation and the framework of the house of our faith. But as Jesus came and began to disciple those who would follow him, he knew that it took more than the thou shalt nots. He began to flip that and say, well, if thou shalt not do this, what should you do? What I found in my life is if those boundaries are drawn in that thou shalt not, there's just something in me that figures out, then how can I? You know what I'm talking about? It's like a child. If you tell them not to do something, as soon as they can, they're going to go and figure out a way to test those boundaries. It's almost wired within us. We don't like just having rules that say don't do that.
And so Jesus, as he began to instruct his disciples, took, and as he did in this, you've heard it said, but I say. And as he would follow that, it was always a way that took the positive of the thou shalt not and said, this is what you should do. Let's kind of jump into that. One of my favorite stories of all times, probably my favorite story of all times, is Les Mis. Any of y'all read that or seen the movie? The story, how many of you have not seen it, so I know how much I need to, okay. I'm not holding anything against that. You illiterates, y'all should have already seen, That's not what I'm doing. But let me tell you the story. The story is about a man named Jean Valjean. And it's this massive saga of the evolution of a person in the midst of the French Revolution. Jean Valjean is not well off, and so the story begins with him trying to steal some bread to help feed the family. And in hard times, the justice is hard, and so Valjean is captured and put in prison, and he begins a kind of a conflictual relationship with one of the people in the prison and later one of the officers. And he slowly but surely, because of stealing bread, gets broken down. And even though in prison he does some heroic things, slowly but surely his spirit gets eroded and he becomes very hardened. He finally escapes, and as he's fleeing, he ends up being hosted in the house of a bishop. And I've got a little clip from one of the movies I want you to watch that has to do with what happened with Valjean here, if we have it.
Is anybody there? So we'll use wooden spoons. I don't want to hear anything more about it.
I'm sorry to disturb you.
You caught him.
But I had my eye on this man.
Oh, and thank God. I'm very angry with you, Jean Valjean.
What happened to your eye, Monseigneur?
Didn't he tell you he was our guest last night?
Oh, yes. After we searched his knapsack and found all this silver, he claimed that you gave it to him.
Yes. Of course I gave him the silverware. But why didn't you take the candlesticks? That was very foolish. Madame Gillot, fetch the silver candlesticks. They're worth at least 2,000 francs. Why did you leave them? Hurry. Monsieur Valjean has to get going. He's lost a lot of time. Did you forget to take them?
Are you saying he told us the truth?
Of course. Thank you for bringing him back. I'm very relieved.
Release him.
You're really letting me go?
Didn't you understand the bishop?
Madame Gillot, offer these men some wine. They must be thirsty.
Thank you.
And don't forget, Don't ever forget. You've promised to become a new man.
Promise? Why are you doing this?
Jean Valjean, my brother, you no longer belong to evil. With this silver, I've bought your soul. I've ransomed you from fear and hatred. And now I give you back to God.
Doesn't matter how many times I watch that, how many times I read it. It goes against everything in our being for that kind of grace to happen. But I want to go back to the scripture. Give to those who ask. And don't refuse those who wish to borrow from you. You've heard it said you must love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who harass you, so that you'll be acting as children of your Father who's in heaven. He makes the sun to rise on both the evil and the good. Sends rain on both the righteous and the unrighteous. If you love only those who love you, what reward do you have? And I love this next phrase, remembering who Matthew was. Don't even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your brothers and sisters, what more are you doing? Don't even the Gentiles do the same? Therefore, just as your heavenly Father is complete in showing love to everyone, so also you must be complete. Marinating that for a minute. Kind of makes you like thou shalt not steal just by itself. But what Jesus continually said is pretty much this. People commit adultery for a reason. People steal for a reason. And Jesus was not as interested in the stealing as he was the reason. He talked a lot about greed. Sometimes people steal because they're greedy or covetous. See previous commandments. And we feel like we should have access to everything. But what Jesus knew more than anything was most of the time when people steal, it's because they don't have. That's an uncomfortable truth that we'd rather not talk about. It's an uncomfortable truth that Jesus walked around in every day. It's why he gave us Matthew 25 that says, when people are hungry, you feed them. When people are thirsty, you give them drink. There were no qualifiers in any of that. And he looked at his followers and said, if you've done this to any of these little ones of mine, then you've done it unto me. You see, for Jesus, it was just as important that his followers understood that was stealing was wrong for them to know that being generous and gracious was right. That how we deal with the struggles and the tribulations of those around us are our responsibility. Hear me very carefully in this. No matter where you stand politically, this is not a liberal or conservative issue. This is not about the government fixing things or creating new programs. This is about the call of Christ to say that the very fundamental things within our culture, those boundaries which get broken again and again, don't just happen. They happen for a reason. And many times, things like stealing, things like crime happen because there's this incredible disparity within our culture of those who have and those who have not. When I was at the annual conference, one of my responsibilities was to be over all the nonprofits. And as I talked to people day after day about things we could do to change the poverty in our world, to address the crime in the Delta, to look at the situation and circumstances we were in, I became more and more aware that it was not healed or made better by money. The Kellogg Foundation came, we had written a grant, and they came to us and said, we're pulling out of the Delta because we've put over $500 million into the Delta over the last 10 years and poverty has gotten worse. Crime has gotten worse. So in this scripture, Jesus doesn't say just if people need something, give it to them. If people borrow and need it, loan to them. He goes on to say it's deeper than that. Why you do that matters. You do that because they are brothers and sisters who are children of God just like you. And Jesus gets pretty explicit. He knocks out the loopholes we would put in this. God sends rain on the just and the unjust. God loves every person. And as followers of that God, we're called not to only love those who are kin to us or care for those who are related to us or make sure those who we know have what they need. We're called to do more than that. I love the way the NIV translation says, you love those who are your enemy and who harass you. Sometimes in the office, as the calls come in, it feels like it's harassing. Oh, Miss So-and-so, this is your 14th call this year, and you need your power bill paid. But you want to know what the bottom line reality is? She needs her power bill paid. And let me cross a line that you probably don't want me to cross. And that is, yes, we live in a culture where we make our own way, we create a living, we gather things to us. That's our right and our privilege to have and make all the money we want. As Wesley said, make all you can, save all you can, give all you can. Somehow in our culture, we've kind of created markers for success that are in many ways inverse of the markers of success of the kingdom. We catch a glimpse of that in that second chapter of Acts when, oh my, this socialist idea that people had all things in common. And those who had need, those who had, gave to them. At the very core of this is a principle that is a kingdom principle, and that is everything is God's, not yours. You are a steward of it. And the object of your life is not to finish with a giant retirement plan and a huge house. The object of your life is to stand in front of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords and hear him say, "When I was hungry, you fed me. When I was thirsty, you gave me drink. When I was in prison, you came and saw me." I want to read you another parable. We don't hear this preached much because it's really uncomfortable. But it goes with this whole thing. It's not enough to say don't steal. Don't take what's not yours. It's absolutely essential to say give to those who have need. Be generous, not greedy. There was a certain rich man who clothed himself in purple and fine linens and who feasted luxuriously every day. At his gate was a certain poor man named Lazarus who was covered in sores. Lazarus longed to eat the crumbs that fell from the rich man's table, and instead, the dogs would come and lick his sores. The poor man died and was carried by the angels to Abraham's side, and the rich man also died and was buried. While being tormented in the place of the dead, he looked up and saw Abraham in the distance with Lazarus at his side. And he shouted, "Father Abraham, have mercy on me. Send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in the water and cool my tongue, because I'm tormented in the flame." But Abraham said, "Child, remember that during your lifetime you received good things, whereas Lazarus received terrible things. Now Lazarus is being comforted, and you are in great pain. Moreover, a great crevice has been fixed between us and you. Those who wish to cross over from here to you cannot. Neither can anyone cross over from there to here." And the rich man said, "I beg you, send Lazarus to my father's house. I have five brothers. They need to be warned so that they don't come to this place of agony." And Abraham replied, "They've had Moses and the prophets. They must listen to them." And the rich man said, "No, Father Abraham, but if someone from the dead goes to them, they'll change their hearts and live." And Abraham said, "If they don't listen to Moses and the prophets, then neither will they listen to someone who rises from the dead." In a crazy world like we live in, it's so easy to come home and put our garage doors down. It's so easy to watch the news and look at the crime and blame the craziness of the world. It's a lot harder to roll up your sleeve and to find the Lazaruses in our world who've been left outside the fine tables. Can I be really blunt and offend some of you? If we spend as much resources finding the people who stole from us of our own in the Christian community, I'm not talking about government resources. And what I'm talking about is people resources. It's not enough to write a check. People like Lazarus need people as much as they need food. They need love as much as they need their water bill paid. Because life has broken a lot of people. And some of them have been broken for generations. And here's God's crazy plan. We're the ones that he's called to change that. Jesus understood, and he said it clearly, the poor will be with you always. But he also turned around and said, but you better feed them and make sure they have what they need. And what they choose to do will be their choice. But what you choose to do if you follow me is not your choice. I made it very clear. So here's my homework for you. Almost all of us, I was about to say something that's going to date me, but I'll say it anyway. How many of you still reconcile your checkbook at the end of the month? Those of you who do that electronically, it comes back. We do that, why? To see what's in our account and to know where we stay and if we can pay our bills. I want you to reconcile your generosity. I want you to look at where you spend your money and ask yourself, how much kingdom work have I invested in? How many of those who need have I come alongside of? Now hear me very clearly. I don't mean that you give to feel better yourself, because the truth is that's what we do. Oh, I'm going to write a check. I feel good. I'm so generous. Part of the burden and the blessing that God gives us as his followers is that we cannot walk through this world with our eyes closed to the pain and the suffering and the need and the brokenness. I'm going to close with this. Many of you know that I had an experience several years ago of being homeless for 24 hours. And one of the first things we had to do was go to a park and beg. Never in my life had I done anything like that. I kind of thought it was funny. It was cold. I didn't have a coat, because we had to get only 5 pieces of clothes out of the clothes closet. I'd never had that problem before. I could always put on as much clothes as I wanted. As I took my seat on that park bench, one of the pieces that I had was a sock hat. And it was so humiliating that I just kind of took that sock hat and held it out and just dropped my head. Over the next hour, I was spit on twice, cussed out multiple times. I had people get up in my face and tell me to get off my lazy butt and get something done. The anger, the hatred, broke my heart and my spirit. I couldn't speak for a little bit after we were through, because I'd never been humiliated like that before. And you know, when it was all said and done, I had zeroed money in my little hat. Here's what I want to say to you. You don't really know that person. You don't really know why they're there. You don't know what broke them or made them angry. But here's what Christ wants you to do. Did you hear the words of the bishop? Jean Valjean. Today with this gift, I have bought your soul back. I'm giving you a chance to become a new man. If you know the rest of the story, it is a wonderful story of redemption and grace that changed Valjean forever and also changed many of those around him. In that story of the rich man and Lazarus, it's the opposite dynamic. The hatred of Lazarus ends him in hell. Y'all didn't know a Methodist preacher was capable of saying that word, did you? And in his torment, he wants the grace that he would never give. Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt love those who hate you. Bless those who harass you. We are called to care for the broken. Even those who, when given the grace, don't receive it in change. At the table at the Last Supper, Judas was going to betray Jesus. He'd sold him out in his greed. Jesus had the chance to out him right there. But instead, he offered him grace. Judas, do you want to do this? And he did. And here's what I want to tell you that I believe. If Judas had not died, I think Jesus would have gone to him just like he did to Peter and to Thomas and to the other disciples. And he would have said, Judas, do you love me? Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, so many times we live in the comfort of our boundaries. We know it's wrong to steal. And even though we may plagiarize a little or steal somebody's mower that we borrowed, not intending to steal it, just not taking it back, that's not what most of us wrestle with. What we wrestle with is living generously in a very ungracious world. Dear God, help us to understand that it's in grace and generosity that lives are truly transformed. It's not just that people get their power turned back on, or they have a safe place to live, or they have food to eat. It is that they encounter your love through our generosity, and it strikes their very soul. And for some, it changes their very life. May we at Heritage look for the Lazarus and give them more than crumbs. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our invitational hymn is Blessed Be the Tie That Binds. Couldn't be more appropriate. Let's stand as we sing verse 1 together. God in His generosity has given us our life. The least we can do is give some of our life to those who don't have it. For God so loved the world that He gave His only Son. So go and live loved in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen and amen.